Praise the Lord, brothers and sisters, and thank you very much for joining us in this video. We pray that you and your families are well. Hopefully your week has been going great and you are encouraged to continue to walk with the Lord and to grow spiritually each day. So we are thankful, always thankful. In everything we give thanks, no matter the circumstance, no matter what's going on, we're always aware of the fact that God is always good. So we want to take this moment just to thank God and to praise him for all the wonderful things that he has done for us. We are here. Not only are we ministering and speaking to the saints in King Street, but we're also going to use this time to speak to the saints in Sumter as well, and all who may view this video. Our pastor is recovering and resting, and we do thank you for your prayers and your concerns, all of the wonderful forms of encouragement that have been sent his way. And he does thank you for all your prayers and all the things you have sent by word. We do ask that you continue to keep him in your prayers, that the Lord will continue to strengthen him and bring him back into the fellowship of the saints. All right. So let's take a few moments. We're going to spend a few moments studying the Word of God. I always think that it is a good thing to study God's Word. I don't think we can ever study his Word enough. All right. This is something that we can never say we are doing too much of. All right. So we want to look at Philippians chapter 2, verse number 5. Very popular verse. We're going to read this one verse to start us off. And then we're going to kind of consider some of the things that are surrounding this text to help us understand what Paul is trying to demonstrate and encourage the saints in Philippi to do. All right. So Philippians chapter 2, verse number 5, it reads, "Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus." And for a few moments, we're going to speak on the topic, the power of right thinking. All right, the power of right thinking. I think this text is very important, not just by what is said in this single verse, but more so by everything that is said around this verse. Paul is in mid-conversation with the church in Philippi when he gives this commandment or give this exhortation to have the same mind of Jesus Christ. And there are a few things we want to consider. Whenever we go to a word or a verse, should we say, we want to always consider the context and understand what's going on, what would be the events that are surrounding the exhortation or the verse that we are considering. And if you look at chapter 1, Paul is explaining to the church the life that he has committed himself to. He understands that his lifestyle, the way he lives, is something that is quite different from other individuals. He understands that there is a great devotion that is present with him to Jesus Christ that may not be found in other individuals or even other Christians. But what he wants to do is he wants to encourage the saints that what he is experiencing is absolutely necessary and it is important for the furtherance of the gospel. And then he wants to show them that his way of living is an appropriate way to live one's life as a follower of Jesus Christ. So Paul would often do this in all of his letters, really. He would say, "Look at my life, because I'm a follower of Jesus Christ." And he would actually invite the believers to follow him as he is following Christ, meaning everything you see me doing, it is safe to do because what I am doing is what Jesus did, all right? And a lot of times when we talk about Jesus, we do acknowledge him as our Savior and as our Lord because he is all of that. But the thing that is really important for this particular moment of existence is the fact that Jesus is our Lord. We are his disciples. And that means that our entire existence should be focused on living as Jesus lived and determining and defining how he lived so that we can understand how we must live, all right? So this is very important. I think I often like to draw attention to this because I don't know that enough tension is always placed in the world, you know, when it comes to Christianity. I don't know that the world recognizes how distinguished of an individual Jesus was to everybody else, all right? Literally, the person of Jesus, the individual, Jesus Christ, was the most perfect human being that has ever lived. And Jesus is the example. He is the standard of humanity. All right. And so if we don't get humanity right, it's because we're not living like Christ. So to be fully human means to be Christ-like. And that's why we must get this right. Now, the question becomes, how do we do this? Is it as if we can just go to the book and just read, and then we'll find out, hopefully we'll develop the discipline to practice what we find out by reading the Bible? Well, we might try that, but what often happens in this sort of scenario is that we become so driven to be perfect that we miss what really matters. And one of the things that Jesus did often is he criticized individuals for trying to dot every I literally without first fixing their heart, fixing their inward man. Meaning you can strive very hard to do everything perfectly outwardly, but there's still this component of our existence that we cannot master by ourselves. That is the inward man, the part of us that no one sees and no one is able to recognize or no one is able to discern without the help of the Lord. That is the part that we must master. And so when we look at Paul's instructions in Philippians chapter 2 helps us to understand that the key to discipline, the key to complete devotion and commitment to Jesus Christ, is the way of mastering our thoughts and our mind. Now, when we look at Philippians chapter 2, verse number 5, at first glance, we really may not know what to think by this word mind, right? So we have to define that word. We have to understand, what did Paul mean whenever he uses the word mind, and what might the original recipients have understood whenever he uses this word mind? Let this mind be in you, which was in Christ Jesus. Some translations translate it as attitude, which is to convey that we should always have the perfect attitude. But even that usage of the word does not properly convey just how important it is for us to control our mind or even our attitude. There's even more there to that word than that. And literally what Paul is saying here is that if we really want to be like Christ, if we really want to do things the way that Christ would do them, we have to control the way we think. In other words, we have to control our thoughts, all right? And I would just say this, one of the quickest ways for the enemy to defeat us and the enemy to get the advantage over us is by interrupting the way we think, all right? Everything about our existence, everything that we do, all of our behaviors, all of our habits, all of our demeanors, all of our attitudes are motivated by how we think, all right? So it's very important, brothers and sisters, to control your environment and not allow negative things to become a part of your thinking, all right? It is very important that we allow our thoughts to be defined and to be controlled by Jesus Christ himself. And one of the ways to best do that is to find out who the man was, all right? I'm a very huge proponent of that. So what Paul is doing here in this chapter is he is teaching the believer how to dwell with his brother, how to fellowship, how to serve, how to think about life in a way that is inclusive of not only self, but everyone else that might be around. And the truth of the matter is, as human beings, we are naturally compelled to think about ourselves first and primarily. So to think in a way that is different from that means that our thinking has to be controlled by Jesus Christ. And we have to now adopt a manner of thinking that is uniquely exampled by Jesus Christ. And he tells us kind of like how we can do that. All right. He tells us in verse number 7, what Jesus's mindset might have been, what his train of thought would have been. I often ask this question, how could Jesus come down here with all the authority, all the royalty, all the rights that he had, all of the power that he had, all of the wonderful things that he could have done, and yet the very most important thing that Jesus does is he goes and he dies on the cross. He doesn't go and build a big house. He doesn't go and buy the greatest horses and chariots. He doesn't gather fame. He doesn't gather great wealth. The one single most important thing that Jesus does is he goes, he is whipped, and he is submitted to suffering. He dies on the cross. He is put in a grave, and he rises the third day. How could a man with such ability do something like that? How could a man with everything that every man could ever want, right in his absolute being, he could avoid all the temptations of this world and live in such a submissive way? The reason why he was able to do that is because his thoughts were dominated and controlled by the will and the purpose of God. And truthfully, what it means to think like Christ, it simply means to think with the will of God first, to think with all of our thoughts pertaining to what God desires, what God imagined for this world, and more specifically, what God imagined for us as individuals. All right. Now, that can be difficult at times, because whenever we adopt this sort of mentality, we often see ourselves as compromising our lives. You know, a lot of people think that they don't want to be saved or be a Christian because they feel like they have to give up things that they would receive for being a Christian. All right. That's why most people would rather prolong their salvation and say, I'll wait till this time so that I don't have to give up what I would rather enjoy right now. All right. And here's the thing, brothers and sisters. The reason people think like that, the way we think like that sometimes, is because our mind hasn't changed. It takes a change of the mind in order to see that heaven is far more valuable than anything you can ever get on this earth. You have to believe that. You have to be convinced of that. You have to believe that when Jesus says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these other things will be added to you, you have to believe that the kingdom is worth having. Whenever Romans 12 tells us that we must be transformed by the renewing of our mind and that we must present ourselves a living sacrifice, you have to understand and believe that you sacrificing yourself is far more beneficial for you and far more valuable than you going out and living without any regard to what God has planned and purpose for your life. That takes a mind change. Our thoughts must change. So when Jesus came down here, Jesus understood there's nothing in this world that I'd rather give up than what I am going to inherit by obediently glorifying the Father. One primary example of this is in the Gospels. Whenever Jesus was driven out to the wilderness and Jesus was offered everything that could have possibly been offered to him of value, he was offered a kingdom. He was offered all of these different things by Satan. But notice what Jesus did. Jesus did something that neither Adam or Israel was able to do. He denied temporary success and gratification in order to receive eternal bliss, approval, and praise of God. He denied superficial glorification, and he submitted himself to the will of God so that he can obtain eternal glorification. So one of the biggest challenges of humanity is to say, I deny any temporary appeasement, any temporary pleasure, so that I might dwell eternally in pleasure with my Creator. All right. And many people will wave off this sort of idea, this sort of thinking, because our minds are geared to get what we can get now rather than what we can inherit eternally. This is why Adam ate of the fruit in the garden. This is why the nation of Israel, they violated the covenant in exchange for temporary success and gratification in the promised land, put off their belief of God, Jehovah, and accepted the idols of the land. There's one individual that seemingly got it right besides Jesus Christ, and that was Abraham. The Bible says Abraham wandered among a land as a stranger, looking for a city whose maker and builder was God. All right. That's beautiful to me, brothers and sisters. That lets me know that Abraham's priorities were in order. His thoughts had been changed by God. And he saw that what I am seeing now, that's not all that there is. There's something else better to be inherited. Everlasting bliss, everlasting joy, everlasting presence with the Father, with the Creator of heaven and earth. And he looked for that. And the Bible says he was a stranger in this world. Brothers and sisters, I want you to know this. When your thinking changes, this is whenever you are able to accept that this is not your home. As the old song says, you're just passing on through, all right? So it gives you the tenacity and the courage, and it gives you the stamina that you need to fight and go through anything this world will throw at you. Because you understand, as Solomon said in the book of Ecclesiastes, whenever we all done with this life, we all got to stand before God and we have to give an account for the things we have done in this body. And that's when life really starts, all right? So Jesus understood this, and his thoughts allowed his life to be governed in such a way. There are four things I want to give you about Jesus Christ that we can adopt for our own selves to help us control and manage our thoughts in a way that will be likened to the thoughts and the ways that Jesus carried his life. The first thing is in verse number 7. In verse number 7, the Bible says, let's start at verse number 6. In verse number 5, he tells us Jesus had this sort of mind, and he begins to explain it in verse number 6. It says he was in the form of God, but he didn't think it robbery to be equal with God. So Jesus knew his worth, but he didn't allow his worth to control his behavior. In other words, there has to be a something about us that says, you know I'm a child of God. I know I have power. I know I have rights. I know the Lord is with me. I know that God has given me great promises. But I'm not going to allow that to compromise my responsibility or thwart my devotion to service. Because every child of God is called not to live in your true identity, but to live as a humble servant. In other words, you have to, in many respects, downgrade yourself. That's why, you know, when people do things to us, we don't retaliate back, because we know we're living beyond our own personal pride. We're living in the image of God. This is why we don't exchange evil for evil, but rather in exchange for evil, we give good. This is why we love those who hate us, because even though we have a right to stand up for ourselves, we have a right to do things to, should we say, take vengeance for ourselves, we remember that though we are the sons of God, we're living as servants. We're living as servants of the Most High God. And now isn't the moment to take the reward. We have to live knowing that the reward is to be inherited in the future. So Jesus came down here knowing his worth, but he didn't live the way he should have lived. The Bible says in the book of Isaiah that when you looked at him, you thought he was one scorned by God, but really he was living as one scorned by God for the sake of those he would serve, he would help by going on a cross and dying for our sins, all right? So you're not what you look like, all right? You may look like you're living deprived and you're not living in privilege and in honor and fame, but the truth is God's people are always disguised. You can never really see their real worth by looking at them. You see it by how their minds are controlling their actions. And if we are really able to discern the people of God, that is when we see the most valuable people in the world, the greatest people, should we say, in the world that can really change and impact the world in the way that it needs to be impacted. All right. Look at what it says in verse number 7. Here's the first thing I want to point out. The Bible says he made himself of no reputation. That's the first thing I want to put up there. Jesus lived in a way that said, it's not about me, it's about the Father. One time a man came to Jesus and called him good. And even though Jesus is the most perfect human being we've ever seen, Jesus says, why do you call me good? There's none good but the Father. What is Jesus doing? He's pushing the attention from himself. He's making sure that people will look at him and glorify the Father. And in fact, he taught his disciples to do the same thing. He says to his disciples, do good works. All right. You are the salt of the earth. You're the light of the world. Do good works so that people can see your good works and not glorify yourself, not glorify you, not look at you and say how great you are. But when they look at you and see the things that you're doing and the way that you're behaving, they'll say all glory to the Father. So Jesus came down here and he never made himself a reputation. He denied the fame. In fact, many times when Jesus did a miracle, he would say, tell no one. All right. And many times he would do a miracle and he would flee and they had to find him. All right. Why would he do this? Because Jesus was not about grabbing the attention or developing a personal reputation for himself. He wanted people to see the magnificence and the glory of God, the glory of the Father, so that when Peter looks at him, he doesn't see a man, but he says, you are the Son of the living God. And Jesus responds to him and says, flesh and blood have not revealed this unto you, but my Father, which is in heaven. If Jesus was here today, the task of the believer would be to look at the man and see beyond the man and see God. All right. And that's how Jesus established the reputation of the Father, God, by doing things in a literal and physical body. All right. We have that same task as believers and followers of Jesus Christ. The next thing says he took upon him the form of a servant. So the second thing I want to bring up to you is that Jesus committed himself to service. When Jesus was teaching his disciples, he says, let no man call you master. Let no man call you rabbi, because there's only one rabbi, and that's me. All right. He says, but all of you all are servants. And what I want you to do is understand this principle. The one that is the greatest servant among you, he is the greatest in the kingdom of God. All right. If Jesus was here in the flesh, Jesus would be walking around serving everybody. And as believers, we should never, ever be too big, too important, too spiritual, too much filled with the Holy Ghost so that we cannot serve other people. All right. Service is a part of being Christian. We have to serve in some way, form, or fashion. If we have the right thoughts, then service becomes habitual. Verse number 8 says this, and being found in fashion as a man, he did this. He humbled himself. The word humbled in its original language has a connotation of being humiliated. All right. Jesus was probably the most humiliated person in the world because he never had any right to be embarrassed in the way that he had been embarrassed. All right. The fact that he could have boasted in his identity and his person, it actually makes his humiliation all the more insulting. But he did this. He did this for us. How could a man do this? How could somebody so great do something like this unless he had found a way to master his thoughts? Brothers and sisters, I would submit to you that if you are able to master your thoughts, there's nothing in this world you can't do. There's no godly thing you cannot do if you learn to master your thoughts. All right. Here's the last thing. Not only did he humble himself, but the text says he became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. The Bible says he obeyed. All right. Now, one thing that Jesus did that is very interesting to me is he said, everything that I do, I see the Father do. Everything I say, I heard the Father say. In fact, everything I'm doing is in complete compliance with the will of God. This is the task of every believer. It's not just to become saved so we can go to heaven, but to become saved so that for the first time in our lives, we can finally say, everything about my existence is in compliance with the will of God. No man can say this unless they have been born again and they have allowed Jesus and given him the access into their heart and mind so that every bit of their thinking is now controlled and inspired by Jesus Christ. There's a song that we used to sing back in the day. I want to be just like him. I want to be just like him. And you know, those are powerful words. But here's the question. If we really ever found out who Jesus was, would we still want to be like him? If we really knew what Jesus would do in every situation and at every moment, would we really want to be like him? The truth is, if people really knew Jesus, most of them would not want to be like him. But I want to tell you this. I found out who Jesus is, and he is the most amazing individual that has ever lived, the most profound, the most sincere and authentic, most devout, holy and righteous being that has ever lived. He got everything right. And my desire, my heart's cry is, Lord, help me every day that you allow me to live to become more and more like Jesus Christ. Because if I can do that, I'm finally becoming what you wanted us to be when you first said, let there be light. And that's the duty of man, is to get back to true and authentic humanity. All right. So brothers and sisters, I want to encourage you, let's let God take over our thoughts. And a way to do that is in every moment, let's pray and say, Lord, give me the way right here. Give me the right way to think about this. Give me the right way to process this moment that I'm in so that my thoughts can motivate my behavior in a way that will please you. And the more we make that a habit, the better off in life we'll be. We'll be more successful. We'll have more peace. And we'll be more like the people that God wants us to be. So hang in there, be encouraged, continue to put your trust and your faith in the Lord. And I believe, brothers and sisters, the Lord is going to take you places that you never thought you would go. All right. So until next time, continue to be prayerful. Please continue to lift up our pastor in prayer. Continue to pray for one another. And Lord willing, we'll see you Sunday and we'll fellowship through those means. All right. Until next time, God bless and take care.